What is up, amigos? Today we're talking about supersonic double wedge aerodynamics. So we'll be going through the shocks that form over this type of airfoil, which is a very common supersonic airfoil, and also how to calculate the lift and drag of it, because we had one of your amigos ask us in one of these videos, Aero Fundamentals number 45, this one here, how to do that. So in terms of the shocks, this is actually quite straightforward. So let's say we have the flow coming in here and the Mach number is greater than one, so it's supersonic. Now, as the flow comes along, it's going to hit this front point here, and it's going to be deflected up a little bit. So this flow that's coming in is going to be deflected this way. That means you're going to have some flow hitting other flow. And because we're traveling at supersonic speeds, the flow really can't get out of the way fast enough. So that means we start to get an oblique shockwave forming. And we know that oblique shockwaves from past Aero Fundamentals videos, that they're not isotropic. That means that you have losses through them. And past here, often we will have subsonic flow, sometimes not. And then as we go along, the flow comes along here. Now the flow starts to get expanded over this corner here. And this results in an expansion fan forming. So a bunch of shocks forming, smaller shocks, weaker shocks. And that results in the flow being redirected down and staying attached over this face, hopefully. And it also happens along this side as well. And expansion fans are usually isotropic, which means that we have no losses through them so that they can be reversible. And then as the flow comes along here, we get to the end here. And now we have two jets of flow really meeting each other, and they're going to then push each other away. And that means that we get another shockwave forming at the back here. And again, this is going to be an oblique shockwave, so it is lossy. So that is the general shock pattern of a double wedge airfoil. How do we calculate the drag and lift over this? Well, generally speaking, past the first oblique shockwave, usually the pressure is fairly constant. So along this entire face, it's generally about the same pressure. After this expansion fan, sometimes it is the same pressure across this entire face, sometimes it changes. And let's say this airfoil is at 0 degrees. So we can say that the pressure on this face is the same as the pressure on this face, and the pressure on this face is the same as the pressure on this face. So we have P1 here, and P2, which equals P1, and P3, and P4, which equals P3. Now, in terms of lift, they cancel out, but we can still go through and calculate if they didn't cancel out. Let's look at the drag first, because usually it won't cancel out. We can see that we have different pressures around here, and usually the drag will be in the direction of drag, so it'll be positive drag, not negative drag, i.e. not thrust, but regular drag. So in terms of calculating the drag, how do we do this? Let's talk about the angle that this face is being deflected at. So let's say it's epsilon. And let's say the thickness of this wing is T. The length of this wing is L. So the point from here to here, let's say it's symmetrical, is L on 2. And this angle here is epsilon as well. So in terms of calculating the drag, what we need to do is figure out what the drag on each face is from the pressure and then summate them. So in Aero Fundamentals number 45, that original video I linked at the start of the video, we go through how to do this for a regular airfoil, and it's a very similar process here. So in terms of drag, drag equals P1 times L on 2. So this face, we're decomposing this pressure into the drag direction, so this direction here, sine epsilon minus P3 L on 2 sine epsilon. So that face there, and it's negative because it's acting in the opposite direction, plus P2 L on 2 sine epsilon minus P4 L on 2 sine epsilon. Now we know that P1 equals P2 and P3 equals P4. So this results in drag equaling 2 P1 L on 2 sine epsilon minus P3 L on 2 sine epsilon. And now in terms of what L on 2 sine epsilon equals, actually let's first cancel out these twos. So we have P1 L sine epsilon minus P3 L sine epsilon. So what does L sine epsilon equal? Well, in terms of the actual triangle, it's actually the thickness. So we can now actually put this as P1 minus P3 times the thickness is the drag. And that's how powerful this is in terms of supersonic. It's usually more simplified because P1 and P2 compared to subsonic airfoils, P1 and P2 are usually constant along the space. P3 and P4 may change, but if they are constant, then we can use this approach. If they are not constant, we can use the approach in Aero Fundamentals number 45. We just need to then integrate across this surface here. Now, in terms of the lift, it's the exact same process, but now this obviously gets turned into cos instead of sine, because we're now in the other direction in terms of decomposing the pressure. So this face there, and it comes out to be a very similar thing. So that is the aerodynamics of a supersonic double wedge airfoil, which is the most common supersonic airfoil really there is, and the shocks that form over it, and how to calculate the lift and drag over it. So if you like this video, make sure to like and click the subscribe button, and I'll see you soon. Peace, amigos.